So it is my pleasure to introduce Ryan Gilbert, the co-founder and chairman of Better Finance. Sometimes it's nice when the people I'm introducing aren't in the room, so they look kind of fresh when they come in. Ryan is, Better Finance actually was formerly known as Bill Float, founded in 2009, and recognized just this past year as the fastest growing privately held company in San Francisco. The company creates easy lending options for small business. Not that long ago, there was a segment on NPR where it was featuring the opportunity to lease mobile phones, lease with the intention to buy. So that was kind of an interesting segment on something that Better Finance is doing. Ryan is no newcomer to financial technology. Prior to founding Better Finance, he also founded Property Bridge, where when he founded that, he was in the East Bay Business Times, and they recognized him as the Real Estate Entrepreneur of the Year. That company was sold to MoneyGram for just a shade under $30 million. I think that's right. Just a shade. And as you'll see, as we speak with more and more entrepreneurs, it's a serial thing. It's not just one or two startups. And starting, I think, last century, actually, one of his earlier startups was Brand3 Inc., down in L.A., which offered desktop marketing solutions to merchants and end users. He's a sought-after advisor for the finance industry. He's a board member at Bcash, I'm assuming that's how you pronounce it, B-K-A-S-H, in Bangladesh, also at River City Bank in Sacramento. He's been an advisor to Square since 2009, which I assume is right since it was founded. And he's well ensconced in our community here. And while that's the case, you may notice as we start talking that he does hail from somewhere else, from Johannesburg, South Africa, where he has a degree in commerce and laws. Now, why it's more than one law, we'll find out. From the University of, I really like this word a lot, Witwatersrand. How do you say it?
Witwatersrand.
I get to say it again, so we'll talk about that later. So please join me in giving a warm welcome to Ryan Gilbert. Water.
Great. Water's good. Thanks. Hey, everyone. How are you doing? Good. Anyone here from South Africa? No one. We got one. That's great. Hi.
Just one, huh? Interesting. So I am so happy to have Ryan here. You've heard me talking about him. I've never actually talked to Ryan about so much business as I will be doing today. And so in the room, we have a lot of people with an engineering background. Not everybody. A lot of people with a CS background. Not everybody. A lot of people are interested in software, hardware, know a lot about that. But I think we have a minority of people who know a lot about fintech. And so while we often start by talking about the journey, I thought if you'd be okay, you could do a little primer for us as our own personal financial advisor and talk to us a little bit about financial technology. And if you wouldn't mind, this is a quick one maybe, could you tell us how you define financial technology and perhaps how it's changed in the last 10 years?
Well, Vicky, thanks. We actually neighbors a couple of houses or streets away, and when you emailed me last year to say do this, I thought, wow, I didn't even know what you were doing. So it's great to learn about the center and all the innovation happening here and meet all of you today. If you look at reports of happiness and despondency in any market, whether a developed market or a developing market, and you ask folks are they happy or sad, a lot of it has to do with money. Even from a young age, kids start getting allowances or want money to buy candy at the store down the street. And I just find it's phenomenal that where there's so many more important things in our daily lives, money, the quest for money, what we do with money, issues about money, touch us from an early, early age. And that's the reason why I'm backing companies and starting companies and running companies that have to do with money. And it's a global issue. About a year and a half ago, I was asked by the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation to represent them on a board of a company in Bangladesh called Bcash. And Bcash is like a MoneyGram or Western Union in Bangladesh doing domestic remittances. If you take your shirts off, and I'm not saying do that right now, but look at the labels, probably 50% of your shirts and everything else you're wearing is made in Bangladesh, no matter what brand you put on it. It's made by people that are working in 8-hour shifts on a recurring three-shift-a-day cycle far away from their homes. But every couple of days, they are sending money using their first generation mobile phones, not our fancy iPhones, to send money back home using a service called Bcash. 25 million daily users out of a population of about 130 million using the service. So when the folks up in Seattle asked me to be their board member and an independent board member on the board of this company, I thought, wow, isn't that phenomenal? Sitting here in San Francisco, coming here from South Africa, helping a company in Bangladesh figure out how to allow their users to convey cash. The crazy thing is, I met the founders of this business about 7 years previously at a conference in Dubai, a conference about money and remittances. So this is a global challenge and certainly one that folks globally are trying to find common ground and make differences in. The key challenge, though, is no matter how good the entrepreneurs are and how cross-applicable and easily to export the technologies are, markets are so very different. There's probably more innovation from a regulatory perspective happening in Bangladesh than there are in the United States with our 50 states. The most innovative country today probably is Kenya, which has a very vibrant economic and financial services system because the Ministry of Finance and the Central Bank of Kenya has really adopted mobile technologies and others to drive mobile payments. So I'm super excited that I can live in the East Bay, work in San Francisco, be on the board of a company in Bangladesh and really enjoy the world. The only downside is there's a lot of travel. But it's amazing that you can cross the world in about 3 days and still go to a board meeting. So that's what I do.
So when you think about fintech, you said you're talking about companies that convey cash. Is anything in financial technology, would it be at the very low, it's anything that where cash is conveyed?
I think it's anything where cash is a contributory component. It's the ability for me to send money to you, for me to walk up to a merchant and use Square to buy an ice cream, on University Avenue. Mm-hmm. It's the ability for me to use a robo-advisor to put $1,000 in a bank account and let the algorithm decide where I should invest my stock. It's my 401k, it's our payroll system, it's disbursements from Blue Cross to my doctor so that I only have to pay a $10 or $20 copay. It's pension systems, it's the IRS. The biggest payments company in the world is the IRS. And it's a phenomenal payments company. It actually works. It works because it's got the power of the federal government behind it, but think how many transactions go through 99% of them quite flawlessly, and the rest are fraudulent.
I have no idea. I'm just curious. Do you have any idea how many transactions do go through the IRS?
Probably too many, but that's a whole other issue.
Especially as we're coming toward April. Well, what about like financial services? Is that separate from fintech? I just kind of want to level set on what we're talking about.
So, if you read the tech crunches of the world today, it's clear that the valuations of companies, particularly in the financial services and fintech space, have certainly inflated significantly. And if you look at publicly traded companies today, they've come down significantly, probably trading at about 20% of their post-IPO highs in the past 6 months. And I think financial services is something that has been around since through biblical times. I mean, everyone's been transacting, traders, government, people between themselves. Peer-to-peer isn't new. Believe me, it happened in the days of David and Goliath, probably with stones or animals. But fintech is really something that's popped up, at least when I consider it, probably over the past 100 years. When banks were starting back in the days of the early part of the prior century to find technology to make their businesses a lot more efficient. Okay. The ATMs were probably the first mass market implementation of fintech, replacing tellers. Today, however, I've stopped using the word fintech. I really think it's overplayed, and I'm a lot more interested in technologies that are applicable to financial services. I think those are the same technologies that are applicable in education, in government, in healthcare, in other areas. And a prime example is a company like DocuSign, the electronic notary, that is just as applicable when you're opening a bank account or signing for a loan as it is to sign a declaration that gets submitted to the court or for the chancellor of university to sign a letter of accreditation for a student. That's really interesting. So the worlds of technology are also coming together.
So, I mean, the words that got tossed around, and Professor Sidhu talked about this a couple of weeks ago, are like Bitcoin, and then how Bitcoin is also with blockchain, which I actually watched a video on today to make sure that I kind of understood what it is. How does that fit into fintech? Or does it in how you think about it?
I think the blockchain and the transactional derivative of it, Bitcoin, fits into everything. It's a it's a searchable or indexable store of value that we should all be using very, very broadly. But it's been grabbed on by the fintech community because it's considered to be another way to both store and then convey value in a manner that is verifiable and can be trusted. Probably the one currency that we don't have in this great financial services world is trust. And if you can create an environment that is trusted.
Which is what blockchain does.
Should be. That's what we're told.
Not Bitcoin, but blockchain.
Blockchain. Mm-hmm. Hasn't been breached yet. Probably will, but we'll have to watch that
but
space.
But so far. Interesting. Yeah. Some students also had questions on, like, where do you see crowdfunding fitting in?
Mm-hmm. Crowdfunding's great. I just think trust also comes into crowdfunding. You can't, you know, I don't think you're going to crowdfund a skyscraper. You can't crowdfund the new Warriors Stadium, although that would be quite a brilliant idea. We could all become owners and get our seats that way. But I do think that crowdfunding is a very important layer in any entity's equity and debt structure in order to get where they want to go. We're seeing some really interesting companies that have a combination of crowdfunding, particularly in a local environment, as well as lending or debt coming from more institutional investors. And the institutional folks really like that because if you can get your local customers and your neighbors invest in your business, the odds are that they'll think like owners and come back and transact in your stores. So it's quite amazing what's happening. Kickstarter is a phenomenal platform and Indiegogo. The challenge is, of course, is bad actors always get in. So you can be part of a great Kickstarter campaign that can raise lots of money and then they never deliver. So there is in order to get trust, you'd hope that there's some type of due diligence performed by the platforms that are making these opportunities available to ensure at least that the entrepreneurs deliver.
So one thing that helps enable trust, I guess, is when you start doing equity-based crowdfunding, because then you actually do have a part of a company. There's been some movement in equity-based crowdfunding. Can you talk to that a little bit?
Well, the Jobs Act has certainly been the primary move over there, and I mean, it's a bit of an insider baseball issue. Those that were the biggest promoters of the Jobs Act and spent a lot of time lobbying in both the on a federal level and a state level did it because they were the entrepreneurs building these companies. It wasn't something that came up, you know, through a process that's more typical with federal legislation. But what is interesting now is at least at certain levels, the SEC is taking a very close look, and particularly crowdfunding from an equity perspective. Crowdfunding from a point of view, if I say I want to develop a new rocket ship that's going to go to Mars in the next, you know, 6 years, back me. There's no SEC to sanity check me. It's probably going to be a couple of engineering students who can call BS on that. And I don't know what's going to be more powerful, the SEC or you. And I suppose it's up to all of us to police what's going on in crowdfunding environments, as we do in all other activities of our daily lives.
Huh. Interesting. Speaking of policing or not policing, Wall Street is really getting hammered, especially as of late, and probably with movies like Big Short out. Has anybody seen The Big Short? It's a really good movie, but it really gives financial services or finance a fairly bad name. It sheds an unpleasant light on, I think. I'm wondering if you have any insights on what's happening, you know, in the markets and kind of this doom and gloom, and a lot of it is related to trust. Mm-hmm. So,
well, I think markets lack certainty. And people lack certainty. And what we have today is very uncertain. And I think it's driven by two drivers. One is certainly China. And probably uncertainty there is being driven by what's happening in the capital markets and the fact that if their markets, particularly the Chinese markets, drop by 7% for the first time in the past month, there's automatic triggers that shut off trading, which is a false sense of security because it rolls through the next day. And certainly, you know, for Chinese New Year and Happy New Year to everyone, markets are closed for a week. So I think that our local markets are going to have a lot of ups and downs this week, as we saw today. It gyrated. But the other thing is more close to home. We in the United States today, thanks to our democracy, don't have stability. Coming in, I was just seeing the results, initial results in New Hampshire, and the polls, as predicted, are coming through. And with Sanders beating Clinton, and I didn't see the Republican numbers, it's uncertain times. And I think that global investors want certainty. So are you more likely to you know, go after real estate assets or others than equity-based? I think Americans are still spending. Last year was a very active year. Car sales were 17.5 million units, like high, and that says a lot. But if we live in uncertain times, things are going to be bad. There's going to be a lot of red ink.
Well, I mean, everybody, I was talking to Nicola earlier about jobs and people thinking about jobs, and naturally things kind of come down to jobs. You had a lovely positive job story, but do you think that people are kind of going to weather the market for a little bit as things are going up and down, or what do you think is? I mean, to what extent do you think that's going to have an impact on what's happening in Silicon Valley in terms of even hiring? A little bit outside of your area, yeah. But I'd appreciate your perspective.
Well, I can say without any hesitation that hiring in the Silicon Valley is going to slow down. I'm hearing it from entrepreneurs that have raised large dollar amounts in recent months, and they've clearly said to me and others that we've raised our money. We were going to be at, say, 300 employees this year, but we're going to pare it back to 225. For good reason, because if things do go bad, you want to be in a position where you've got enough runway, so to speak, in order to ride this one out. And I think that's very, very prudent. The worst thing as a manager entrepreneur is to do layoffs. It's probably, I don't wish it on anyone at any time. So if you can avoid it, being prudent about your hiring, you should do it. I think what we will see, though, is more Americans are going to probably look at what they're doing every day and say, you know, take this job and shove it. There's that country song that said that, Willie Nelson. And be your own boss, you know, run your own business, decide who you're going to hire and who you're going to fire and keep it for yourself. And maybe we'll see a massive return to small business growth and entrepreneurism. I think that could be real exciting.
So you are your own boss, mm-hmm. but one question just to kind of round out talking about finance. Thank you, students, for submitting interesting questions. And I thought this one was kind of interesting. Often one hears about the intense monotony of working in the financial sector. Do you, as a financial tech entrepreneur, ever experience this?
No.
What's your day like?
Well, my work's been changing a lot as my company's developed and as I'm doing more things in the venture capital space. But I'm trying to have my day start where I can worry more about my wife and my kids and then worry a little about myself and then go to work. And at my age, over 40, you tend to forget what it's like to be able to run a mile and swim a mile and do all those things. I'm trying to do a little bit of that. But then my day is about really just focusing on the high-level stuff. I'm very fortunate that in my companies we've got good managers who I trust, who I've worked with for a long time. And I think the most difficult thing for me is to pull myself out of the daily management and say, right, you know what you're doing. You've built this with me. Run it. And I'm trying to invest in good companies.
Can you talk a little bit about what Better Finance is today?
Yeah, so today... Today, Better Finance is the owner and operator of SmartBizLoans.com, which originates and packages SBA-guaranteed term loans in partnership with banks. The SBA is a federal government agency. It provides guarantees for loans that banks originate to small businesses, subject to very particular terms. And it's been put in place so that businesses that are early stage, not startups, but typically have 2 years of tax experience, that's one full tax return and a stub year tax return, can go to a Main Street bank and say, you know, we may not be the typical organization that you would submit a loan to, but because of the guarantees from the federal government, we can qualify for a loan as small as $5,000 and way up into the millions. And the problem, though, that any lending program has, particularly one that's sanctioned by the federal government, that's subject to federal law and what's known as the SOP, or the Standard Operating Procedure, the amount of paperwork that goes into those lending programs is unbelievable. It's like this thick.
Did anybody fill out their own student loan applications by chance? I mean, that's pretty gross too.
Right. And let's draw some comparisons. In the student lending space, there's a huge amount of disruption going on right now, particularly for folks like you at this school, where you can go to companies like SoFi or Earnest and others that have made it a lot easier and are creating a community and are hoping that you land up with good jobs and will back you if you want to run a startup and will help you get your first home loan and car loans and everything else. But what they've done, they've turbo-taxed the process. Think about filling out your own tax return in the next couple of weeks and not using an online system, an electronic system, and going to the post office at midnight on the 15th. We don't do that. You go on your phone, you submit the return, boom, you're done. Why isn't that easier done in all other instances? So whereas the Earnests of the world and the SoFis are solving student lending and Lending Club and Prosper are doing so-called peer-to-peer lending, we focused on the SBA guaranteed term loans.
So So how much do you all, what's the amount of loan? I mean, how many loans do you all have out there? Or what's the total amount?
So the SBA programs originate well over $2.5 billion of loans a year. We focus on the smaller loans because what we see in financial services is very clearly big banks don't want to make small loans. The same amount of handling and risk management goes into these loans regardless of size. But we like the small loans because nobody else is in there. And today, the combined loans that Better Finance has originated through SmartBiz, and I'm looking at the Q4 2015 numbers, put us in the top five, number one being JP Morgan Chase, number two being Wells Fargo. We'll be number one at the end of this year. And the way we're doing it, we're not a bank and we never want to be a bank, but we work with other banks that come to us, trust our systems, tell us what they want the underwriting to be, let our technology do the underwriting analysis for them. They, of course, own the final decision. And we package it up and send it over and put their money to work.
So if I'm getting a loan, let's say I am a small business, I'm doing an SBA loan, I think I'm working with, did you say JP Morgan?
JP Morgan, yeah.
I think I'm working with JP Morgan. Am I actually doing all the technology stuff with you all?
Yeah.
And I don't know that?
Well, you're coming through smartbizloans.com, and as soon as we've packaged up your application, we will send it to the bank. And then you know you're working with us and the bank. But I can tell you one thing for sure. When you want to refinance or get another loan, you're going to come to us because we gave you that experience. And fintech today, remember what I said earlier about trust, is also about that user experience. It's worrying about how many clicks you have to get from here to the end. It's the phone call that you get to say that your application's been received and that things are working out. It's the flowers that our loan consultants get back, or the fruit baskets. We're getting a lot of those fruit baskets delivered. Thanks from the entrepreneur for getting us this loan in 30 days versus 90. So it's pretty cool, and it was quite a journey to get there, but I'm glad we're here today.
Fruit baskets, I like
that.
I'll have to remember that. I want to shift. Thank you for taking a while just to kind of level set, tell us what's going on or how you see things. I want to shift a little bit, and I do want to talk about your journey. It's interesting. I think it can be said that you have a fairly non-technical background, and please correct me as we're going through. But it'd be nice if you could tell us a little bit about your journey from the time at Witwatersrand. I thought I was going to say it again right, and I think I didn't. But if you could tell us a little bit about, you know, when you were in the seat, because you were saying it doesn't seem like that long ago. And frankly, with this group, anything you can tell us about failure, things where you really made a faux pas, anything you wish you could have done differently, something horrible that happened, we want to hear it.
Well, for the record, especially, the journey. So when were most of you guys born? Okay, that's when I graduated law school. So it's a long way back. And I went to law school in South Africa. I always wanted to be a lawyer. LA law was great. It's, you know, it was like, man, if that's what it's about, certainly there.
Do you all know what LA law is?
Yeah.
Okay, three people. It's a show.
LA law, the A-team, only those are classics. My kids watch them today. But growing up in South Africa in the 1990 through 1994 period was a time of a lot of change. And I really enjoyed being in student leadership back in Johannesburg at my university on the student council, which is like the student senate here. And it really just struck me how much this change had opened up for us in South Africa, that with South Africa's admission to the nations of the world, our first time participating in the Commonwealth Games, Olympic Games, international sport coming back in, you could leave South Africa and be part of this bigger platform and this bigger world. And I wasn't the only one to have that experience. There are a lot of South African entrepreneurs in the Bay Area and indeed in the United States that have done pretty well for themselves because we play hard and work hard and have a lot of fun at the same time. And I had an opportunity, thanks to work I was doing with Anderson Consulting post-law school here in the United States, where I got friendly with a guy from the U.S. Commerce Department based in San Francisco, who out of the blue called me to say there's an entrepreneur in San Francisco who wants to open up a business in South Africa using a software. Can he connect you up? Well, next thing I knew, 2 years later, I landed up here, was in partnership with this guy running a startup, which we ended up selling to a company in Germany. And four startups later, I am here where I am today.
But you had studied law, commerce and laws, laws, however they say it. How on earth did that work with the connection with
Anderson?
It sounded like it was more technical.
Well, I always wanted to be in business, and I, you know, you'll laugh at me, but I coded BASIC in high school, so I know a little bit about a little bit. And I think that one thing that became clear is if you're not going to be practicing law, is there ways that you can apply your legal background to what you do? I am an active member of the State Bar of California. I do my CLEs. I wrote the bar exam when I came over here, and it's a way of keeping involved. And I think most entrepreneurs that are involved in what's happening in our area, the Silicon Valley, are either hardcore when it comes to the technology side of the business or focusing on the business side of the business. And over the 20 years doing this, I've learned a lot about the tech side of the business, a lot about the business side of the business, but I think the most important lesson I've taken away is the people side of the business. That, you know, it's one thing for me saying I want to do something, but I'm not going to be a solo entrepreneur. I have to be in a position where I can surround myself with good people who will probably know a lot more than me. And if I do that, it can be quite good.
So we had a question from a student, which I thought was interesting. Mm-hmm. Berkeley students often find that we have to compete with other top schools, such as those in the Ivy Leagues, when it comes to resources and job outlook. Having come from a university that is outside the U.S. and isn't easily recognizable as the said colleges in the U.S., yeah. This sounds like a lawyer who's written this. How were you able to seek the resources that enabled you so much success?
It's a great
Ipso
question.
Facto.
So I've got four kids, and I talk to my kids about what they want to do. My little girl wants to go to NYU. She's just decided on that. At least one of the four know where they want to go. I'm sure you've had folks come in here, or you heard about people like Peter Thiel and others say, quit school, go and do the startup and that. And I think I can subscribe to the same type of thing. And what I say may be something that will be the last time I ever get invited to a place like this,
but I'm going to say it anyway.
You know, don't believe everything anyone's always told you. Make the decision for yourself. It amazes me how many great success stories have come out of the Wits University or the University of the Witwatersrand, Johannesburg, the school I went to. Absolutely amazed me how many of these great leaders I run in every day in all fields, from medicine to law to politics to engineering. And I think that the education and the grounding you're getting over here puts you in a super enviable position relative to the rest of this planet. You know, I'm talking about guys that I've met in Bangladesh who go to their local Institute of Technologies. But what you do with it when you leave these hallowed halls is what matters most. And I hope they're teaching you one thing here, which is grit, because it's tough out there. So to answer the question about the competitive nature, we've hired at our company a lot of folks from UC Davis. A lot of our leadership team tends to come from Stanford and then a smattering of the other schools. And I've worked over my years with partners who have been alumni of this university. You may say, well, why so many Stanford folks in your management team? Because of the alumni network. They've pulled them in. When you start with one guy, he pulls in the others. Why so many Aggies? It started with one and now we're at 15. It's a really interesting thing that goes. And I think when I see applicants come in from Cal, whether postgrad or undergrad, there's a huge amount of respect. But there's also respect because I think what you're learning at this institution is a little different from what's being taught elsewhere. And it goes back to the history of this institution and where UC Berkeley has been with respect to human rights and civil rights and every other type of rights. And I know a lot of people say it's Berkeley, you know, stay away. No, I say come here. And I think it's phenomenal that you're here, it's great, but take what you've learned, be proud about it, be strong, and go out and compete.
So it's interesting that you talk about grit, because when I we're very good friends with Stanford, and we've had a lot of speakers here from Stanford, but I always have this feeling, and I hearken back to a gentleman named Alex Stamos, who is with Facebook and security, and he talks about, like, when you're at Stanford, you're given a little book, and everybody's a little snowflake. But at Cal, you kind of have to fend for yourself, and you got to figure it out. And it seems like through that you develop grit. So the combination of having the network from Cal and grit should be a great combination.
Yeah.
Entrepreneurship wasn't as sexy 30 years ago as it is now. In fact, when you thought about being an entrepreneur, at least I did, it was probably opening your own retail store. Maybe it was different. Do you think that there was something about what was happening in South Africa that made you think about it differently, or just because of the historical context? I mean, that was kind of either pushed you out or pushed you into being a little bit more risk-taking?
Well, I think my father's an entrepreneur. He's in real estate and he's done other things, and I've got a lot of my inspiration from him and a lot of my learnings, but he also paid a lot back to his community. He was an elected member of the Johannesburg City Council for a while, and I think the two of those things go together. The flexibility of being your own boss gives you a lot that you can do. You know, the South African story, there were big companies, there were small companies, so I think it's more what happens in your family than what happens in the country that you grew up in.
Are there a number, I would love a show of hands. Is there anybody who is not, is actually here who didn't grow up here? I'm just kind of curious. So I am kind of curious, you left South Africa. Any thoughts to go back? Any thoughts of like taking all the information that you have and doing something back in South Africa?
Lots of thoughts, but I wouldn't do it today. I think the political situation and the current leadership is not one that inspires returning human capital or financial capital. I think we want to see where it settles out. And we're very happy in California.
Interesting. Just curious. Kind of thinking back, I'd like to hear a little bit more. You talked a little bit about college and then how you came over to, somebody had kind of called you from commerce and said, yeah, come on over to San Francisco. Did you come to San Francisco or LA?
Straight to San Francisco, yeah.
And then what happened? And then all of a sudden you started founding or co-founding companies?
Well, I did startups all the way through. I think one of the, this probably goes to the immigrant mentality. It's really difficult to get the big jobs at the big companies. So what do? You come to America, and what do? It's land of opportunity. You join a startup or start a startup. It's easy to do. So that's what I've done.
How did you find people to start up with?
It's easy.
How is it easy? It's only easy for certain people. So
yeah, well,
what do you think makes it easy for you?
So the first company was the result of the introduction through the guy at the Commerce Department. The second company was with engineers and people that I worked with at that company. The third company had the same type of thing. You build community all the way through. You pick folks up on the way. Think about work like going to a bar. Pick someone up every day.
So yeah. I just saw you pick someone up outside.
Yeah, I did. I picked him up, yeah.
I think Travis is here. Travis was talking about something and suddenly Ryan reaches out and pulls out his business card and says, call me. Question for you. Yeah. Do you expect him to call?
I think he will call, yeah. He should.
Were you the type, when you were receiving a card from someone, did people do that for you?
I'm not lecturing Travis now, but let me tell you something.
I'm sorry, I don't even know where he is.
If somebody's going to make an effort to say, give me a call, and it's not just gratuitous and there's something really behind it, follow up. And even if it's just an offhanded introduction, connect on LinkedIn. It's so easy today. You don't have to write a letter, sign a letter, lick a stamp, send a fax. It's like, boom, connect to me on LinkedIn, and you're there. And all of you connect to me on LinkedIn. I'll link back. You never know where this can go. Follow me on Twitter, RG Office. Just do it. This is the beauty of the technology that we have here today. And if any of you have a crazy idea in the financial services space and are looking for seed investors or Series A investors, or you know a person who needs that backing, follow up. Folks like me always respond. We're in the people business. That's what we do every single day. And you know, I say the other thing is don't be afraid to float crazy ideas and take a shot. Please do not ask anyone doing what I do to sign an NDA. We see too many crazy ideas all the time, and it's this point of awkwardness. But your success is going to come from your gumption and your ability to execute. And I think all of you can do that. So you got here, which is a first step on the road.
So what was it about Bill Float when you first saw it that, I mean, you're saying, you know, float an idea across. What was it about Bill Float that you thought was interesting, that was an opportunity that 6 years ago you're like, okay, this is what we're going to start to do?
Well, we had an opportunity to partner with a good venture capital firm and a strong financial services company, being PayPal, to find new ways to underwrite consumer and small business credit. And I thought that was really exciting because we don't have to focus on using credit scores from any of the primary bureaus, Experian, TransUnion, et cetera. Mm-hmm. And that's what we did first and proved that it could be done and continue to take the learnings that we had by taking shots at multiple products, some that worked, some that were failures for not always financial reasons, but for other reasons, to arrive where we are today with SmartBiz.
So speaking of Twitter also, it seems, I don't know if it's your motto on Twitter or for it's taking giving credit, not taking credit,
yeah.
Which is interesting. What are you like? I'm wondering if that's your motto as a boss, or I'm wondering, you've had some like big decisions.
You should ask
that
people I work
made.
With. Yeah.
Well, what would they say? You know, what's important to you in being a boss and having had bosses?
Well, in the Twitter sphere and on LinkedIn and Facebook and everywhere, Look at the bragging that goes on. There's a lot of it. I'm in the business of financial services. A large part of what we do is credit related. And we give credit to small businesses. We've enabled in the consumer space. And I think our work, in order for folks that work with me to feel that they are doing well and making a contribution, you've got to recognize them. I mean, if you're the CEO or the chairman or the investor in the deal, you've got your equity. It's pretty baked in. You're quite solid. But think about the rest of the team. Bring them up. Make them feel empowered. Give them an opportunity to do new things, to do risky things, to embrace a little bit of failure. I think it could be quite a building experience. So I live by that one.
So not that this was a failure, but it was certainly a change. And I guess there's an article, and the title was, I imagine it's something you said, sometimes you just have to use the F word. Huh. Can you talk a little bit about what's behind that and what happened?
I got when that went out, my mother called me straight away from South Africa and like, she didn't use the F word.
Could it be like fear, failure?
No, I think the F word is focus. So let's talk a little bit about focus. The one criticism that I've always had leveled on me from my outside investors and my board is focus. And I think if you're an entrepreneur with a great platform and a lot of big ideas, focus is very, very difficult to do until you've truly got the recipe done right and you can nail it. But there comes a time where you've got to have the focus. And certainly for us in the business, the past 2 years or so has been very much about the focus and the prize where we are today. And that's a big thing. And I fully subscribe to the F word.
So, fantastic. And so what happened was that you sold a part of the business, mm-hmm. a big part of the business.
Big part of the business.
And that was the part of the business that was focused on?
Consumers.
On just the consumer. Yeah. So now it's all small business
yeah.
that you're focused on. And interesting. And somebody had this question. I don't know if this came up or not, but when you make a decision, how do you make a decision when your beliefs conflict with that of your team? Did you have, was there anybody else who did not feel comfortable with that decision? And how did you bridge that, if that was the case?
Well, there's always going to be times where people feel uncomfortable with decisions being made. Especially if there's a disagreement. Mm-hmm. But loyalty gets developed over time. It's again tied to the trust. And the one thing we've tried really hard to do in all the years is to be transparent and to over-communicate. And that, you know, during the times of change, it meant having regular check-ins with the entire company, no matter what role the audience had, to let them know where things are coming at and the ability to also take real questions. I'm happy to field any question about anything. And if I'm not going to answer you, I'll tell you, unfortunately, I can't answer you. And I've got good reasons for doing that. And I think that's a great way to run a business. And the person who taught me that is Jack Dorsey from Twitter and from Square. In the early days of Square, it was quite amazing how Jack was out there. Everything was transparent. I believe it still is the same case today as a public company. Certainly, there are restrictions. But if you can build in that open door policy and full transparency and collaboration, you can build a very, very strong culture. So that's how we overcame that. But eventually, though, you've got to make a decision. And you can't always just have a debating society. That's not going to get you there.
So you said something earlier that somebody asked you how you're liking your job. So I think that kind of gets around with like you're making a decision. And you said, it's not my job. It's, well, can you talk
it's
about
not my,
that?
Yeah, a couple of weeks ago I was with an entrepreneur I know quite well from South Africa and I've just invested in his company. And he said, so how are you liking your job? And I stopped on Sansom Street, we were on the way to Blue Bottle, and I said, what do you mean a job? I don't have a job. I'm an owner. I enjoy doing what I'm doing, what I do. And I really believe that that's, you know, if you're going to be an entrepreneur and go after that, that's the view you should take. A job is something you do from 9 to 5 or other constrained hours with no input and work to rule. But if you can take another view, it's not a job. So that's my view on having a job.
I think it's
joblessness should be great. We should all hope to be part of the jobless data that comes out every couple of weeks. I'm happy to be there.
There you go. One student asks, as an expert in real estate and financial services, how did you find the right technical partners and make technical decisions to help you leverage digital platforms as the proper foundation for your products?
Well, I'm blushing at being called an expert. Thank you, but you're wrong. I read a lot and I learn a lot, and I hope I know a little bit about a lot that helps me get through and make good decisions. The real hard work, particularly in fintech, is being performed by those who can take the large ideas and tie them to the business model and actually write the lines of executable code and ensure that it gets delivered in a way that thrills the user and delivers something that's safe and impenetrable from a risk management perspective. And the clear path for me to find the teams that we put together has always focused on bringing on one or more product co-founders or technical co-founders. Folks that really like doing what they're doing and then can hire and be mentors to the other parts of the team and to give them full autonomy in running their teams, right down to the hiring and firing and compensation decisions. Because that way, you're allowing them to really establish their own true business units within the business, no matter how large or small. And I think, again, goes to this question of job or not a job. We've managed to create real opportunities for everyone to get out there. And I don't need to manage them every single day.
So, in the spirit of transparency, mm-hmm. what you're doing work-wise every day is that you're working with the end consumer, the small business, but we're in a room full of students at the moment. And I'm wondering if you had any advice for students, initially around the finance area, what would you tell them? And I guess I'm thinking about this in two parts. One, is it an industry to get into and how? And two, for their own finances, what should they be thinking about?
So the financial services area is huge, as you know. And I would beg you, don't go and work for a big bank. You know, I would implore you to be the big bank. And if you look at a large financial institution like Chase or Wells Fargo and just analyze the landing page there at wellsfargo.com or chase.com, think about all the startups that are raising billions of dollars every couple of years that are going after subsectors of their business. And then ask the question, are they trying to digitalize their own institution to compete with the competition that's out there? I think they're trying, but they're not trying hard enough. But if you really want to get in financial services, attack them from one of those vantage points somewhere. There's a lot of fat that you can get through and end up winning, whether it's in payments or remittances, lending, investments, through to 401k management, investment banking, crowdfunding. It's just unbelievably huge, and there's a lot of capital chasing those opportunities. And I think when you look at your own financial lives, what you're managing today, the first thing that I hope you're doing is getting on the credit ladder. If you don't have a credit card, get a credit card, because unfortunately we're still living in a country where the credit report is that one score, more important than an SAT or your scores here at Kell. That's going to get you the credit you need and access the banking systems you need. Once you have that at a reputable financial institution and your score's starting to build up and you're out there working and earning income, think about how you're saving. Think about what you're doing to grow your investments, and I would hope that you are very, very aggressive, because the best time to make money is in a downward cycle like we are now. So, you know, don't buy tickets to the Warriors, and if you did go to the Super Bowl, shame on you. Put the money
unless
into the...
Unless you happen to be volunteering.
Okay, if you did, that's great. Thank you. I didn't go. And invest that. Invest actively and proactively and make your own decisions. I think there's a lot of exciting things to do. And pay off your student debt as soon as possible. Or refinance it. Go with Ernest. Love the guys there. You know? But get out of where you are.
Does everybody know what that is, Ernest? Okay, I don't. Okay. Could you tell me what that is?
It's Ernest is a new non-bank lender focusing on students like everyone here.
So a new non-bank lender, but you tell everybody to go out and get a credit card, and mm-hmm. it's just funny to me when I think about blockchain, which is tracking everything. Shouldn't that be like the new credit, where the credit is kept? Or
it probably will be one day.
But you'd still advise everybody to go out and
I think
get a
we're living
card.
In the real world every single day, and we're dreaming about the future at night. And somehow you have to balance the two up there. Like, so, focus on your FICO score still matters.
So I thought this was an interesting question, and one person, and you don't have to say who you are, but that's all right, was asking how what you do in your business life, but I would ask how in your personal or business life that you do that you think has an impact on society. And then, because we are all a bunch of data geeks, and then, by the way, could you give some data analytics around that impact? But I am kind of curious to know, what is your mission? What's your mission with the business? And what would your motto be for day-to-day life? And so, if you happen to have data analytics, fantastic.
So you'll hear it here first. I'm now chairman of my company. Chairman is more of a non-operating role. I've partnered up with a large financial institution, a global bank, to launch a venture firm, which will be announced in the next couple of days. And every day, the past couple of months, I've been spending a lot of time with entrepreneurs, talking about their businesses and giving so-called free advice. And I think that's something that I enjoy doing. I learn a lot, and I hopefully have helped a lot of folks on their way. And I think it's difficult to quantify, but I know one guy who sold his company for $800 million because of some advice I gave him. And the best thing for me was when he sold his company, he called me up that morning to say thank you. It was
Did
some
you get
great
a fruit
advice.
Basket, though?
No, it was a phone call. The phone call mattered a lot. And I know he knows who he is if he ever hears this session. But what I see is happening at SmartBiz today with the origination of lending with our bank partners, one thing we can measure are the amount of jobs that are being created by the loans originated every day. And last year, of the $89 million in loans originated through our partner banks, about 2,500 jobs were created.
Can you say that number again?
2,500. And that's quantifiable because of the reports that these companies have to give us that we then submit up then. That's a big deal by any count, and we're going to hopefully triple that this year in 2016 and keep on doing that and make it easier for businesses anywhere in the United States to get the most cost-effective loan, which is also the most difficult to try and achieve. In my daily life, outside of the office, I've got my family. That's super important to me, and I hope that my kids can look at what I'm doing and say, you know, my dad's making a difference. He enjoys what he does. He doesn't have to go to work at 8 a.m. every morning and be home by 5. And it's understandable if I'm in Bangladesh for a week. Because the stories that come back from Bangladesh, those are real stories. That if you haven't been there, I'm begging you, go. It's worth the $50 visa that you can get at the airport. Because you see a part of the world that makes the East Bay look like heaven. Yet folks there are building good businesses, running responsible operations, changing the way we're getting the clothes we get. And I think it shows how global we are, that everything we put on us is made somewhere else. And you've got to know the people that are making your clothes. And that's what I've seen. So I hope what I'm saying makes some sense, but it's, for me, it's been a journey that started in South Africa, land up in San Francisco, and every couple of months goes back to Bangladesh.
That's lovely. Thank you very much. So we will take questions. I think we have two microphones, and we have about 10, 15 minutes for questions, and then people tend to kind of gather on the stage afterwards.
Okay,
so
great.
One question way back there. Do you mind waiting for the microphone? And I'm going to let you have the stage all by yourself.
Thank you, Vicky.
Hi there. So I was wondering what your view on regulation is in fintech, because regulation is obviously something that's a limiting factor in the whole, fintech space. And sort of within fintech, what areas do you think is regulation in need of reassessment, and what areas do you think is regulation appropriate right now?
So think about everything we do in our daily lives and ask what that would be like without regulation. The water we drink, the air we breathe, the traffic on 101. We need to, in any part of the world, appreciate that we live in a society of laws and respect those laws. And regulation, well implemented and well thought out and continually evolving, I think can be a great enabler for innovation. Closest to home for me, financial services, and particularly here in the United States, we aren't facing a regulatory regime that is the most forward-looking. I think it's very, very clear that there's a lot wrong with our system, as much as there's a lot right. But to an extent, the regulators have had a very knee-jerk reaction and a populist reaction to the things that are wrong and haven't focused much on what's right. And that's particularly the last 8 years since the 2008 financial crisis. To a large extent, regulators are very, very risk averse. They're not going to be the men in the arena starting new startups. And when regulators and compliance folks typically hear the word innovation, they focus on the word NO in innovation. So put on your blinkers, look at innovation, what jumps out at you? It's not the in, it's not the vation, it's the no. And what I've seen over particularly the past 6 years in the United States, with the formation of a federal agency, the Consumer Financial Protection Bureau, is a modern day agency tackling the question of regulation from a consumer perspective in the financial services market, which at the forefront has a very substantial part of their budget focusing on research. And it's very, very enabling and empowering for all of us to think about a federal agency, a regulator, that is saying before we do anything, we want to understand the markets that we're going to try and do something in. And that's what they've been doing for the past 6 years. So I'm a huge fan of where I think we can go in the future in the United States from a regulatory perspective through the agency like the CFPB. I think we're going to see a lot of enabling legislation coming out. And my evidence for having that point of view is that we, over the past 4 years, have seen programs coming out of the CFPB, for example, a program called Project Catalyst, which focuses on working with startups, actually having open house sessions here in San Francisco to enable people like me to come and put ideas and projects in front of them, supporting waiver programs that will waive for a certain period of time certain aspects of regulation to see how these programs work and to inform new regulatory operations and management. The problem, of course, is though the CFPB is not the only regulator dealing with financial services. We've got state regulators, the FDIC and other banking regulators that regulate the banks, the Federal Trade Commission, which regulates issues such as communications and promises that are being made to consumers. And part of the and then you've got the SEC and other regulators that regulate investment and non-consumer activities. What we are missing in our big country with all these agencies and thousands of bureaucrats is interaction and collaboration and cooperation. And that's maybe the biggest downer. Big government isn't working together. Small new agencies, innovative startup agencies within the federal government are. I hope that under a new administration, whatever the successor administration is going to be, a focus on financial services continues. But if the incoming administration asked me one question, I'd say, install Slack. Get government agencies starting to work between each other, communicate more. Because right now, there's a turf war going on. And when wars happen, the end goal gets missed out. Folks are worrying about their jobs and getting more. Whereas in Bangladesh or the United Kingdom or South Africa, there's a lot more cooperation and consolidation around the agencies. They are working together, they're investing together, and better regulations coming out. So frankly, I'm seeing more financial services innovation popping out of the UK and Bangladesh today than I am out of the United States, the ability to change their countries. Thank you for your question.
Okay. I feel like if we were playing a drinking game and we had the word Slack, that's what we should be using for the series.
All right, so one, there we go.
I'm sure that's an incorrect way to put it. Another question. Yeah. I did reach out to Stuart Butterfield, by the way, if anybody's wondering, to come and speak.
Hi, thank you for coming. My question is about the role of the financial service sector to deal with issues around income inequality and wealth inequality. What do you think that role should be?
That's a great question. You probably all heard about the Super Bowl ad that SoFi wanted to put out, basically telling the audience that most of you aren't good enough to qualify for one of our loans, and they eventually changed the pitch there. I don't believe that great financial services innovations are going to be about broadening the gaps. what we're doing with Bcash in Bangladesh is really shrinking that gap and becoming a major driver in the Bangladeshi economy at a very, very low cost, which is critical. Back here in the United States, though, we have a very different story. And I think that the financial services space as a whole, and all the services and the tools we have, should probably focus on three primary things. Number one, education. At a preschool and a primary level. I don't think that kids today understand money. They are money mad. They know how much a new Lego set's going to cost. They know what a Wii game is going to cost. But they have no idea how hard it is to earn a dollar, how hard it is to save a dollar after tax. And good fundamental education will go a long, long way. There should be more vloggers and bloggers and Instagram sites dedicated to training kids. In fact, there should be, as much as we have civics classes at schools, we should have financial classes from a very early stage. The next thing is lending. Today, the insurance regulators that focus on our banks, the FDIC particularly, is very much opposed to banks making loans to those at the lower part of our FICO level, at the bottom of our financial pyramid. Whereas the CFPB, and particularly Director Cordray, has recently said this afternoon that he wants banks making more investment into low-income credit services at a lower cost. And banks should be able to do that because they've got the cheapest cost of capital and all the branch infrastructure. They'll take somebody's money, but they won't give someone a loan. And that's a problem. We need to fix it. Banks should be freed up to take a little bit more risk and serve all their customers across the board and not say that I'm only dealing with high net worth individuals. I mean, come on, you've got a banking license. Be a bank. You'll take my money, but you won't even give me a loan. I'm finding hard to reconcile the two. The third thing is really to understand our tax system in the United States. It's complicated. And a lot of citizens and a lot of taxpayers are finding it very difficult to comprehend and probably spending more money than they should in filing their tax returns on an annual basis. Now, if you've got zero income and get your earned income tax credit, you can pretty much find someone who's going to do it to you for free. Okay? Free tax returns, much like free money, doesn't exist. But if we had a reform in the tax system that really allows, I'm not advocating a flat tax, but I'm advocating a more simple system, it's going to be cheaper for everyone, particularly those that don't have a lot of money to pay to the tax preparers of the world in order to get loans tied to their earned income tax credit. You can see a huge change overall. There's another thing, and that's something we should think about as well, is given the booms in the real estate sector that we've seen in major metropolitan areas, it's become very, very difficult for those that didn't go to Cal and are perhaps working so-called menial jobs, blue-collar jobs, to even live where they work. And think about the cost on any individual driving 3 hours a day back and forth in order to bus tables in San Francisco on the Super Bowl. It doesn't work. So we've got to fix all those things. It's a massive political problem that financial services companies alone aren't going to serve. But we see the data, and hopefully we can help drive that conversation. Thank you. Sure. Thanks.
One more question.
The back.
As a serial entrepreneur, I'm sure you had many ideas. I just wonder, how did you come up with those ideas? Could you give an example which later on became a success, and another example later on became a, not say failure, but you just gave up?
They all want to know about failure.
Yeah, failure is good. It's really a great F word. So the one thing, I love travel, and I'm fortunate to do a lot of it, but I always keep my eyes open. I'm the guy on BART every morning who isn't staring at his iPhone or isn't reading the newspaper. I'm watching all of you. And I think by observing what's going on around you and really taking those types of hints, you come up with some really, really good ideas. I think also getting out of the United States is a great eye opener. I encourage you to do it as much as you can. Or at least get out of San Francisco, go to Iowa, you know, get out, go to the flyover country if you can, to really understand how folks are living their lives and what's important to them at all times. I wouldn't say that I've failed on projects. I'm not just gung-ho enough to say, great idea, I'm going to do it, I'm going to put money in, and if we kill it in a week, we're going to kill it. I always try and do my homework. I try and sanity check ideas with others, people that I trust, with my wife particularly, and get the take there. And I like to think about the bigness of the opportunity. And my reason for saying that is because entrepreneurs want to build big things and move on and rinse and repeat, particularly if that concept of serial entrepreneur ties to you. And I'm doing that to an extent with a venture firm. It's a startup venture firm, although backed by some very large institutions. So I'm back in the startup mode again. But what I do focus on is, are the companies I'm getting involved in one day gonna be something that can survive without me? Can some of my team step in and manage it and make a difference? Because I really think if you can do it that way, you can create something that's going to last, like American Express, that's been around for 170 years, Wells Fargo, an equal amount of time. And those can stick around. Don't just do it for the quick flip. It's a great one-time event. You pay your taxes, you get some cash, but build something for the long term, and that's what I've really tried to do. So I don't think I've answered your question directly. I've ducked the fail question, but my clear response there is, think through it so you don't fail, and hopefully you won't.
So I am going to ask a political question.
Okay.
And maybe it's not, in all likelihood, this will be an election that everybody in this room will be able to vote in, assuming that you have American citizenship, I suppose. You talked a lot about trust. And so it seems a little funky to use the word trust and politicians in the same sentence. But what would you, you seem to have a good handle on trust and what to look for in terms of trust. And as we're going into this election, are there certain questions that you would recommend that we ask to gauge our trust in a candidate? Not like who you would vote for,
yeah,
but what kind of questions should we ask as we're thinking about electing, unless you all have already made your decisions?
Well, there's so much spin going on right now that I think it's a very, very noisy type of situation. But maybe the one question I'd ask any candidate who, you know, would be crazy enough to come and spend 5 minutes with me and my Moakley crew is, what would you want to do in your first 100 days? And I put that out there because everyone talks about the first 100 days as that most impactful time that you come out with your policies and really get stuff done. And it's also tremendously measurable. I mean, you'll know whether the person's full of it or not, depending on what they say they're going to do the first 100 days. And there's a lot that can be done to change the federal government in 100 days. You can see the power of the executive orders that our current president is able to leverage. So I would ask, quite frankly, what are you going to do in the first 100 days? And measure them by that, because if it's not done in the first 100 days, it's not going to be done in the balance of that term. And then you know what? You're going to be on the other side of them next time. There'll be a one-termer. So give them something small enough to measure and see if they deliver.
I just want to thank you for tactical and strategic advice, and appreciate your being here. And don't move, because people come up and ask you questions. Thank you.
Thank you. Good night, everyone.